1997 with the loss of my mum, and basically I was a semi-professional footballer at the time. Hi, my name is Tommy Kelly. Welcome back to another video. Today it's actually a collaboration with Official Cody. In case you don't know, I've actually featured his channel recently on my shoutouts. He's actually a young boy from West Yorkshire. He's a great, great inspirational channel. Basically, he makes a lot of videos, basically a lot of fun, happy videos, and his main motive is to help other people and make feel everybody that happy in nature, and this is what he's all about. He's obviously went through a lot of mental illness that he talks about, obviously his recent admission to hospital and the mental illness that he's went through and things like that. Absolutely lovely young guy, really, really proud to connect with him and to call him a friend. Basically what we've done is we've asked each other a series of questions and he'll be answering on his channel, I'm obviously answering my channel. The link for his channel will be below, so please subscribe, follow him, he's, like I say, he's a lovely, lovely guy. The first question he asked me, do you think females speak out about their eating disorder more than males? Yeah, I most definitely do. Like I say, my eating disorder started in 1997 with the loss of my mum, and basically I was a semi-professional footballer at the time. Over the next 3 years, I went away to Australia and I was away down to about 5 stone. I actually came off the plane arriving at Glasgow and I took a massive heart attack and I was in a potassium coma for 3 months. And I spent the next 9 months in hospital gradually building my weight up. I had a PEG tube into my stomach to refeed me. And basically, I didn't accept I had an eating disorder, like I say. I didn't want to obviously speak out about it because I felt that everybody would hold it against me. Nobody would talk to me because I felt that it was a female illness. And I feel that that's what a lot of people actually do, males especially. We've got this stigma that it's a female illness and a lot of people out in society think that males should be strong enough and shouldn't suffer with an eating disorder. And I feel that that's what a lot of the issue is. A lot of males don't come forward until they're really, really ill. And hopefully with me and you and a lot of others coming onto YouTube and speaking about their mental illness, we're taking that stigma away. And hopefully that will help them come out and speak out early, because early detection is really, really vital to get full recovery and also to stop the damage done to your body and things. So that was an absolutely great question. Number two, when did your eating disorder begin and do you think it's possible to fully recover? Like I say, it started in 1997 with the loss of my mum to long-term cancer. She actually had the choice of having me and living with the cancer, or aborting me and obviously been free of the cancer. So she actually, obviously she had me and she lived with the cancer. And I blamed myself totally for her passing when she did pass, because I thought that basically I caused it. But now I realise that that's disordered thinking. And my mum was so desperate to have a family and her choice was to have me. Over the next couple of years, I actually, in 2000, like I say, I was in the hospital. I was 9 months in there, potassium coma for 3 months. Then a few years later, I was gradually getting, my weight was getting up. I got back to 12 stone, I met my wife. Then we eventually get married, and then in 2005 she'd suffered 4 miscarriages, which she was diagnosed as polycystic ovarian syndrome, which actually turned out to be ovarian cancer. She had to have a full hysterectomy, and then obviously now we can't have family and things like that. So basically that caused me to have a relapse, because I was so worried about my wife who had ovarian cancer. Then I was another 6 months in the hospital at that point. And what actually happened is I was in a gradual refeeding syndrome, because my body started to actually neglect the food. That basically, that's what happens when you've had a restrictive background. Your body goes into shock because it's not used to the calories. So I was in a gradual refeeding syndrome, 500 calories a day, gradually getting built up. And then, like I say, I got let out of the hospital. My weight had stayed to about 7.5, 8 stone. But my father was actually really, really ill at the point. He was suffering me from diabetes like he had done all his life. Basically, just when I was born, he actually suffered it. That's when his diabetes had started. and he had gangrene in his leg, so he got an amputation, and then he actually took a massive, massive stroke and a heart attack. So he was wheelchair bound, and just over with me and my wife looking after him and caring for him all the time, I just wasn't getting to the point because I was so severely worried about him. And then 2004, which was November 2014, sorry, he actually suffered a second heart attack and stroke, and he actually passed away. And at that point, I just totally gave up. I went into the hospital, and I had suffered from a renal failure. My kidneys and my liver was shutting down. I was in there for 6 months, and then January 2015, I was straight in there to the April 2015. I got let out in April 2015, and this time recovery has totally happened. I went vegan. I had wanted to do that all my life, but obviously I was prevented from doing that because a lot of people do use it as a mask for their eating disorder. But like I say, I'm recovering totally now. Things have really, really changed. I know that I've got to do it for my parents up there, for my wife, and most importantly for myself. And coming on to YouTube and all the support and knowing that I'm helping other people, looking in the mirror, knowing that what I'm doing is not only helping myself, but helping the animals and helping other people recover from their eating disorders, that's really, really, really helped me so much. And basically, do I think it's possible to fully recover from an eating disorder? Well, I do think you can recover, but I feel it's something you're always going to stay on top of for the rest of your life, because that wee voice is always going to be there. It's basically, if you can think of it like a drug addict or an alcoholic, the addiction side of it's very much the same, but they can abstain from their drugs and their alcohol, whereas us, we've got to face our demon and the thing that keeps us alive every single day, and that is food. So it's much, much different, and it's a very much harder coping skill. So I feel it's something we're going to have to stay on top of for the rest of our life and make sure that that voice is nothing but a little whisper on my shoulder. Number three, if you could give advice to your younger self, what would it be? Well, that is a really, really great question. I feel that I would to make sure to live every day to the maximum. Make sure that you send all the love to your loved ones every single day. Send special moments. Let them know how much they're loved, because life is far too short, and we focus upon all the possessions in life, and we don't realise that life passes by so quickly. When you're younger, a week seems to last forever. Yet when you're older, a year just zips by. Life is far too short, and I would just say, to not be hung up upon body image and try to be the best person you can. Spread love to everybody. Do random acts of kindness. Spread the word of the love of the Lord. And that's basically what I would say I would do to my younger self, because I feel that we're too hung up about society being this perfect body image, and there's no perfect body image. Love yourself for who you are. You are special in so many ways. Your body image and the weight on the scale tells you nothing about your gravity pull on this earth. It doesn't tell you about all the people that love you, the people that you've done special things for. Like I say, at the end of the day, people will always remember you for the good things that you've done in your life, and that's what it's about. They won't remember you for the body image that you were, so that would be what I would say. Number four, what do you feel about the treatment around eating disorders, and could it be improved? Well, yeah, I feel eating disorder treatment certainly could be improved. I've actually spoken about this at Parliament for Eating Disorder Awareness Week, which I do for the B charity and the Men and Boys Eating Disorder Service Scotland. I feel that basically when you get taken into hospital, they take you in there just to basically fatten you up. And that is the wrong thing. Eating disorders are not about the food and the weight. It's actually about the mental illness that's up in your head. You've got to be able to deal with those issues, whatever it may be. Maybe you've been bullied, maybe you've had a traumatic past, you've lost a loved one that I had. There's many, many differences that cause an eating disorder, and it's all genetic. It's not something we choose. But obviously you've got to get to the stage where you're in a healthy body to be able to deal with those mental aspects. So that is getting you up to that weight. But like I say, it's like plastering up a broken arm. They take you in there, they fatten you up, they send you back out, and you're basically back out into society with the same issues that you were dealing with before. And that is just totally wrong to me. I feel they should keep you in there and help deal with the traumatic issues that your eating disorder is all about. And probably if I had been that done to me, I wouldn't have suffered for eating disorder as long, sir. That is one thing I would definitely say. And basically, like I say, they do send you into psychiatric units. I feel that they've got to start making dedicated eating disorders units. There is only basically two in Scotland, in Aberdeen and the Glasgow Priory, and they're basically 4 or 5 beds. And even then, it's an eating disorder lottery, because basically you've got to get NHS funding to get in there, and it's really, really terrible. That is a great, great question, Cody. Thanks very much. Number 5, what do you feel about Pro Anna and Pro Mia websites? Well, I say they're very, very destructive. That's basically how a lot of people feel that eating disorders are a choice, because they come on and they see Pro Anna and Pro Mia websites. If you don't know what Pro Anna means, Pro Anna means pro anorexia. Pro Mia means pro bulimia, which is binging and purging and things. I've actually heard that recently there's actually some actual positive pro Anna sites that where they're actually encouraging each other to actually get better, because they're basically sharing their anorexia recovery and things, which I feel that is good, but I feel that like these ones that's promoting binging and purging and getting a thigh gap and how to lose weight and things, it's really, really destructive. And like I say, they don't understand that you can't glamorise eating disorders. They've got the highest mortality rate of any mental illness for a certain reason, and that's because they can cost you your life, and I know that only too well, and I don't want that filtering onto my channel. I tell everybody I'm about pro-recovery, and if you start coming onto my channel and spreading pro-Anna, pro-Mia comments in my comments section, I won't have it. So that is a great, great question. Number 6, if you could give advice to a young person that's suffering from mental illness, what would you say to them? I would just say, please speak out. I know it's very hard, and sometimes you don't accept you've got a mental illness, and you worry about how people are going to react to you and how society is going to react to you. Please speak out to anybody you can trust, whether that be a family member, a friend. You can go online to many mental illness websites now. Be Eat in the UK is one. Men and Boys Eating Disorder Service. There's also Mind. There's National Eating Disorders Association. There's many, many, many. You can look them up. You can go on anonymously and speak on online chats to people who are suffering from the same issues that you are. And that's probably the best therapy you can get. But if you can, please speak out to a family member or a friend. Go and get help for your GP. That is your first port of call. You really need to speak out. At the end of the day, if everybody that really loves you, they're going to accept you no matter what. I like the little moniker that I always say, those who matter don't mind, those who mind don't matter. And that is very, very true. So great, great question. Number 7, what was the main reason for you starting your channel? The main reason for me starting my channel was I just wanted to share my eating disorder story. I didn't actually set out to actually have an eating disorder channel or a vegan channel or anything. I didn't actually set out to actually start a YouTube channel. It was just to share my story and hope to inspire everybody. And then it just gradually grew. People were commenting, wanting to know more. I kept making videos, and it's just boomed. And my main issue is for that is to help other people recover from their eating disorders, spread the vegan message, and just to try and help as many people as I can. Hopefully that they can pick up some things from my recovery that may help them and my story, and to spread the awareness of how eating disorders are not a choice and pro-recovery. That was an absolutely great, great question. He's actually asked a bonus question. If you could be any superhero, who would it be? Oh, that's absolutely great. As you well know, I'm a big superhero fan. I'm a sci-fi geek. I feel probably a lot of people would say Superman, but because he could fly and things like that. But I feel probably Batman, because I feel anybody could be Batman. He's just a regular, regular guy, and he's out there and he puts on a cape and makes devices that can save the society. And he's a crime fighter, and basically me, you, anybody could be Batman, and I feel that's real realistic. He's a guy that's been wronged in life, they've killed his family and things like that, and he goes out and he fights crime, fighting drug addicts and basically people that's trying to destroy the world. And I would say definitely Batman, definitely. He's somebody that anybody could be, and I would love to be Batman. I would also say I like people like The Flash and things like that, the way he can go back in time and things like that and can run fast. That would be somebody else I would probably really aspire to be, because if I could go back in time, I'd go back to the time where I had my mother and father and things like that, and definitely things like that. So this has been an absolutely great, great collaboration. I really, really appreciate this, and I can't thank Cody enough. He's an absolutely inspirational guy, and like I say, please go check out his channel. Like I say, he deserves your support and your love. He's an absolutely great, great guy. Thanks very much, Cody, and I look forward to seeing your video, and I'll speak to you all soon. And remember what this little guy at the end of the video says, he knows best. Thanks, guys. Remember, guys, binge on life, purge negativity and starve guilty feelings. Speak to you all soon and love you so much.